Hello. Hello. It's great to be here, and I'm honored to be here with Michael to discuss his wonderful new novel, a book that, in my view, is as gentle and humane as it is unsparingly honest, and when it needs to be brutal. It's the sort of novel I'd say we need now more than ever. I've spent the last couple of weeks or so with this book, and I didn't want to come out of it. At one point, the narrator describes his grandfather as on a search for the hidden history of loss, loss upon loss unending. And yet, this is somehow, and I know a lot of you have probably already read it, is an extremely joyous book, and a celebration, in my view, of family endurance. So, in a lot of ways, I'd rather be home rereading the book. rather than up here trying to sort of, you know, I feel like it might bust up the magic a bit, but that's my job, and that's what we're doing. It's a real pleasure.
Let's just ruin it.
Right. But we're, so let me start with a basic question, and that is that the book is about many things, and you know, including World War II, the Holocaust, rocket science, marriage, mental illness, memory. But more than anything, it's about one family. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if you could just start, if you could pinpoint the origin, how this began, and at what point.
Well, I mean, one thing about novelists, I think, is, you know, we're known for fabricating, for telling lies, essentially. We're telling lies that are, I like to call it the only good kind of lie, which is the lie that the person you're lying to has asked you to lie to them. they're expecting it, and they want it to
they're
be a good one,
for it.
Right? But I mean, in some ways, I think of all the lies that novelists tell, the biggest one is the story of how the novel started, because I always have to make something up. I don't know if you feel this way too.
I
the truest answer to that question is almost always, I have no idea, really. But what I think happened was that I was planning to write another novel. I had some thoughts about it, was what it would be. I did research. I was sort of ready to start. I didn't have it all figured out, but I thought, okay, at least I'll go out and work tonight and I'll make some notes about what I'm thinking of doing. And I had just finished maybe the day before, Dennis Johnson's novel, Train Dreams, which is a little short, slender novel. If you haven't read it, I recommend it. It's such a beautiful, wonderful book. And he, just in passing, he does this thing in the book. That book is about a one man's life, which in this Moonglow is also, but it's about a man who lives in the Pacific Northwest. He's up in the woods, and it's like loggers, and it's a very hard, kind of tough life that starts around the turn of the last century and goes up through the 20th century, because he lives to an old age. And at the end of his life, or toward the end of his life in the 50s, one day he's in this little town, and there's a train coming through, and the train breaks down and has to stop for a few hours to fix something or put water in or whatever you do with trains when they break, I don't know. And Elvis Presley is on the train, right? And this is this old man, I don't even remember, I feel like he doesn't even really know who Elvis is, or he finds out from what people are saying, and there's just this glimpse of I think he says something like this golden boy or something, or a boy in a golden suit or something, and it's nothing happens, but it's these two arcs. This small arc of one man's life and this huge arc of American pop culture history and post-war American history sort of intersect for this moment. And it was just so beautiful in that, and it tickled me so much. And so I went out to start working on this other book, and I just started thinking about this story that I had heard from my actual grandfather a couple of times in my life, that one of his brothers, so one of my great uncles, was fired from his job as a salesman for company that was in the Puck building in New York City, and they sold like forms for businesses, invoice pads and stuff. He was a traveling salesman selling paper, commercial paper products, and he was fired to make room on the payroll for Alger Hiss. Because after Alger Hiss got out of prison, nobody would give him a job. And this somebody in this company knew him or took pity on him, and they gave Alger Hiss a job, and my great uncle lost a job. And that's it. That's like all I knew. But even in that little story, I had that thought, oh, that's sort of like the Elvis story.
And I can see how using, and this happens a lot, and the book starts with this moment. Right,
I mean, that's where it
starts.
Started.
With Alger Hiss. I mean, it's in the first
I'm probably lying a little less about this origin than I have been in the past about other books.
It's interesting and something that happens a lot, and I'm already going off my script of questions, of which I don't get alarmed, because I have many.
That is a sheaf of questions.
But your use of, you know, the intersection in this book between, you know, real things and real people, von Braun, for example. Mm-hmm. You want to talk a little bit about how, you know, it's interesting bringing up Train Dreams in that tiny moment in that very short book, but it did have a way of sort of expanding the scope of that book by including Elvis, as if, you know, and
it's a way of saying to the reader this, well, for me anyway, as a reader almost more than as a writer, it's a way of saying this really happened.
Right.
And you want to want the proof that this really happened? Elvis is in this book, right? If it didn't really happen, how could Elvis be in this book?
Right.
It would be somebody called like Elrod Bessley or something, right? That's what you would do if it didn't really happen. So, you know, that's, and I've, you know, I came of age as a reader of, you know, adult fiction, whatever you want to call it, serious fiction. Like one of the very first books I remember reading was one that my parents recommended that was a book for grown-ups, was Ragtime.
Ragtime.
You know, and that book was, he was such a brilliant writer, and Ragtime just blew everyone away because he had Harry Houdini in there, and he had Max Sennett, and he had, who else? Tesla's in there. He had all kinds of people.
Firemen.
Real life people in this book, people who actually, Emma Goldman's in there. So, and they're interacting with his fictional characters in a way that it creates, even as a, you know, young kid, I could appreciate there's this strange, wait, what's real here and what's not? And he does such a good job of both making you believe that Emma Goldman is in this book and this is how she would talk and this is how she looked, and that these characters that she's interacting with are also in the book, that it I love that feeling. And there's another writer, Max Apple, who was doing that with the characters like Howard Johnson, the founder of the motel chain. He wrote a short story, The Oranging of America, about Howard Johnson. And Walt Disney, he has a story where Walt Disney's, and this is right around the same era. So I grew up with this idea that this was something you could do. You could have real people in your fictions, and if you did, it would make your fictions strangely, it could make them feel more real.
It's always good to mention Howard Johnson's in here, the restaurant.
Probably.
Let me ask you this. So von Braun, so just to cutting to the grandfather is a main character here, as is the grandmother, and I'm gonna get into those wonderful characters in a moment. But just to stay on this idea of real things, because it does feel, you know, when we talk about it, the book has sort of been described in various ways as a memoir, novel, et cetera. And, you know, it seems to me that, you know, all memoir is fiction, you know, and here we go. And so, but there's something about the relationship in this book, in particular with this guy, von Braun, and maybe you could talk a little, his words start the book, which is, if I could read real quick. Because it's actually a beautiful sentence, even though he's a creepy guy.
Okay, right? Well, go ahead and read it, and then I'm going to have to tell you something.
There's no dark side of the moon, really. Matter of fact, it's all dark.
Okay, is there anybody in this audience who recognizes those words? There's no dark side of the moon, really. Actually, those words were not said by Wernher von Braun. They were there. If you listen to the Pink Floyd album, Dark Side of the Moon, with headphones on, the last thing you hear is the heartbeat is going boom, 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 and it kind of fades out. And just as it's fading out, you hear this man come on and say, there's no dark side of the moon, really. Matter of fact, it's all dark. So for me, you know, this is a novel, right? It is a novel. It's a work of fiction. But I agree with you that so are memoirs. And that's not to disparage them. And I think some of the greatest memoirists find ways, either overtly by telling you right up front, or in more implicit ways of letting you know these are amalgamated characters, or obviously I can't remember what my mother said to me on a sunny afternoon in 1952. It was a long time ago. Right. You know, but as a novelist, I have felt a certain amount of resentment toward the rise of the literary memoir, because it seemed to get accorded a kind of special prestige or favor for being true.
Right.
And it's so clear, ought to be so clear, that of course they aren't true. They may be truthful, but they're not factual.
When I entered this book, and even from the very first line, which I had a vivid memory, just as you had said that, mm-hmm. My college dorm room at the University of Michigan, underneath my bed, was this line.
Really?
Underneath the Eric Klar's bed, he slept above me and I slept below.
Oh, okay, I was going to ask you why you were under your bed.
Under, you know, it was that wooden thing,
yeah,
and written was this quote. And
what?
It is now.
Wow.
So I knew I recognized
that's
it.
That's pretty
somewhere.
Cool.
Anyway, but the question to me is, in novelists, you're always trying to get people to believe, right?
Right.
And so, as you say about Elvis Presley, we start believing. And I start believing, especially when it comes to this Von Braun character and mm-hmm. others in the book who are, quote, real. Mm-hmm. So here's an example. The grandfather in this book is fascinated by rockets and space and the moon. Mm-hmm. His whole life he's been waiting for the moon landing mm-hmm. to happen. And the book, and I'm going to talk about the structure and how it moves around in time, but at one point in the book, the moon landing happens, and
right.
the family's all watching it on the TV, and there it is. And what does the grandfather do? He walks out of the room.
Yeah.
At the very moment,
right.
you know.
He doesn't want to see it.
And so maybe talk a little bit about that scene and his relationship to Von Braun, and who is Von Braun for
sure.
people who don't know.
Well, yeah. Werner Von Braun has for a very long time been best known in this country for being the father of the American space program, right. the conqueror of space. He is unquestionably, he was the single most important person, the single person most responsible for Neil Armstrong taking that step on the moon. I mean, it would never have happened without him. And when I was growing up, I was born in 63, I came to consciousness with the space race and with the race to get to the moon, the quest to get to the moon, and with consciousness of Wernher von Braun in particular, because he was on TV. He was a like a celebrity scientist, you know, in the way that, say, Neil deGrasse Tyson is today. Like,
right.
like you knew who he was, and you knew what he did, you knew what he looked like, you knew who he sounded. He was on the Wonderful World of Disney. He and Walt Disney seemed to be pals, and they would talk about, like, building a space station and a moon base.
Right.
And in a way, that whole vision you see articulated in the movie 2001, that sort of progression to orbit, to the moon, and then beyond into the solar system, was sort of Von Braun's dream. I mean, other people's too, of course.
Right.
That's who he was to me to begin with.
Right.
It was always known, of course. It was always talked about, and he was criticized, and he was mocked. Tom Lehrer had a famous song, because they actually made this very kind of lionizing biopic about him. In the early 60s about Von Braun that was called I Aim for the Stars, right? And then Tom Lehrer has a song where he said, I aim for the stars, but sometimes I hit London. because before any of that happened, he was the father of the German rocket program, and he was the creator of the V2
right.
rocket, which I'm sure, you know, most people know was this, really it was the first intercontinental ballistic missile. It was the first use of that kind of technology, of rocket technology, in a context outside of, you know, fireworks and a few, like Robert Goddard did some tests in this country, but the V2 rocket really started it all, but it started it all in this horrific way. And as horrible as the destruction that was rained on London and on Antwerp and other cities, primarily London and Antwerp, by this, and like one V2 rocket strike hit a movie theater in Antwerp, the Rex movie theater, and I think like 2,000 people were killed by it. And a lot of people were killed by those V2 rockets, but the number of people killed by the rocket explosions is a drop in the bucket compared to the number of people who were killed making the V2 rockets, because they were made by slave labor from concentration camps, not Jewish concentration camps, they were political prisoners. You know, they were Russians, French, Poles, but they were kept in horrific conditions in concentration camps and literally worked until they died. And von Braun denied all of his life that he had anything to do with that. He tried to say he didn't know about it, and then when that got a little untenable, he said there was nothing he could have done about it. It's after he died, especially, it was clearly demonstrated he knew all about it. He condoned it.
In the novel, in real time, the grandfather knows this, or yeah, at least he learns, is uncovering it.
Well, he you know, the grandfather does. The idea of space travel and flight to the moon is sort of this almost like Don Quixote-like vision that he has. And at first, he is recruited to this division, this actual operation that was called Operation Paperclip. Right. That was a U.S. military effort, an intelligence effort, to go into Germany before it was conquered, as it was being invaded. These guys in Operation Paperclip, they were scientists and engineers and soldiers, and they followed the troops, and they had a list called the Blacklist, and they were just, it was a list that had been discovered by accident. It was when Bonn was captured by the Allies, they captured this big scientific university, and a Polish janitor came upon this huge thing that someone had tried to flush down the toilet in the evacuation, and it was this huge, it was a list of like every major scientist and engineer in Germany working for the Nazi government with their, you know, it was in typical German fashion, very detailed, their phone numbers and zodiac signs, I don't know what was on it, but so we had this list, and they were like, go get these guys, right, get as many of them as you can before the Russians get them.
And Von Braun being the top.
Yeah.
It's such a benign operation Paperclip.
I know, right? You know?
But so the grandfather really, you know, if there's a hero of the book, you know, one of them is the grandfather, let's mm-hmm. say. I think the grandmother and the mother, certainly. But can you talk a little bit about how the book started to emerge as you went forward? Basically, the impetus for the book opening, at least it kind of doubles back, is that a character named Mike Chabon, mm-hmm.
No, it's pronounced differently in the book.
Right, it is. It is, exactly, because it's... is spending time with his grandfather who is dying.
Right.
And the character says, you know, he's learned 90% of the information about his entire grandfather's life in the last 10 days of his life. Mm-hmm. Also, in part of that same paragraph, is the character mentions that a large percentage of his estate went to his health care in the last 6 months of his life, mm-hmm. which I appreciated mm-hmm. Him noting. Mm-hmm. But can you talk a little bit about how the character of the grandfather changed as the narrator starts to listen to his story, which is kind of opened up by him being drugged?
Right, yes. No, this grandfather is a very taciturn man. He's in that classic Jewish male mold of there's a certain type of a sort of, I mean, strong, silent type, I guess you'd say. Right. It makes me think of that, you know, that there's the joke about the kid who comes home from Hebrew school and he says to his mom, "Mom, I got cast in a school play." And she says, "That's wonderful. What part are you playing?" He said, "Well, it's a play about a Jewish family. I'm playing the dad." And she says, "You march right back there and make them give you a speaking part."
um, My father didn't get that memo. Anyway.
My grandfather, my actual mother's actual father, was not like that. He was very loquacious. He loved wordplay and puns, and he told story. I knew a lot. I would have said I knew a lot about him based on the things he had told me, or I had heard. I probably would have said something like, I've already heard all of his stories. Let's put it like that. And then when he was dying, my actual grandfather, and I went to visit him, and he was on painkillers. He was just in a terminal stage, so he was just on palliative care, essentially. And he was, as much as he liked to talk, and as many of his stories as I heard all these things I had never heard before. Now, it wasn't anything earth-shattering, but I couldn't stop thinking. I just had that sense of what else don't I know? What else haven't I heard? Like, right. Where is all this coming from? I never knew it was there, and now it's about to leave, and I haven't asked any questions. And, you know, you get to I was about 25 at that time, 24, 25, and that's around, that is the age where you start to realize, oh, wait, they were all, my grandparents and their siblings, were all human beings. You know, they were men and women. They had sex. They had jobs. They worried about all the things I'm worrying about. They did all of these things that I'm doing now in their own way, in their own time. And I don't know anything about any of that stuff. And you can't ask them anymore because it's around that age, typically, when they start to right. go. So, you know, I had that experience of feeling like, what did I miss her? It didn't motivate me to necessarily like write. I didn't think like I'm going to write a book about it someday. But then when I decided to do this, that experience was there. And you know, I think the way the grandfather kind of emerges finally at the end of in this book, at the end of his life, under the influence of these painkillers, and his whole story emerges. In a way, it's kind of like a wish fulfillment, I think, on my part, because that didn't happen, in a sense, right. with my grandfather. As much as I heard, I am painfully aware at my present age of how much I missed, right. And what I didn't know, and everything that it's too late to ask.
It's what fiction can do, right? I mean, exactly. we can make it.
You want to get answers right. to these yeah. questions, right? Yeah. And you know, while I was working on this book, there's a lot in this book about photos and old pictures and trying to figure out who these people are and what happened. And
the saddest when the photo album has three with or four the missing, pictures in it. Yeah, yeah. And she describes the missing.
They're just the four little pasted yeah. corners. Those black corners and the pictures are gone. Right. I came upon this picture of my actual grandmother, and who was a very normal woman, very unassuming, quiet woman who went about her business and did what she was supposed to do, and was not a big, very dramatic person in any way. And frankly, I didn't really think that much about her as a kid. She was my grandma. She was a good cook. I mean, I just didn't, I didn't have a sense of a round person there. I was probably right. too young, for one thing, and that's at least a little bit of an excuse. Right. And then, my mom gave me a big box of old pictures, and I see this picture of my grandmother when she's about 18 in Philadelphia, where she grew up, and so this is like in the 20s. She has Amelia Earhart short hair, like a boy's haircut, and she's wearing knickers and, you know, socks and men's shoes, and she's wearing like a big bulky sweater, and she looks really happy. She has this big smile on her face. And I'm looking at this thinking, like, is this a costume? Well, no, because look at the haircut. Like, you would never cut your hair back then, especially it was a big thing to cut your hair. So right. maybe, did she dress this way? Was this her? Like, who is this person in this picture? And then, of course, then my next thought is, like, there's nobody I can ask. Right. Like, I ask my mom, she's like, I don't know. Right. All the people that could answer the question are gone, too. So, you know, this novel, for me, is a way of trying to, I had to make up an answer.
It's so interesting just listening to you talk about your actual grandparents and what you don't know about them versus the time, you know, I've spent immersed in these fictional, it's just fascinating, actually, just to hear, you know, and I think in some ways that the holes that you're trying to fill in this book, you can feel that. You know, you can feel a mind, the narrator, whoever you want to call this guy, trying kind of desperately to fill that. And I think for me that as powerful a character as the grandfather is, and he's at one point the narrator describes him as he reminds him so much of the character of the soldier in For Esme with Love and Squalor, beautiful Salinger story. But for me, the grandmother really haunts the book, and sort of constantly. And you start very early on. There's a beautiful one of many lists you have in the book, and the list of memories of the grandmother.
Right, the earliest memories.
Yeah, and including the tattooed numbers on her arm. Mm-hmm. And with this line, the jaunty seven with its continental slash, which, you know, is just a way of sort of, I don't know, I mean, it just actually looking at that seven. Mm-hmm. You want to talk a little bit about that list and how that character started to emerge for you also?
Yeah, sure. I already hinted this book sort of arrived in an unexpected way, and I wrote for a few years, 3 years, and I completed a draft, what I thought was the book, or I hoped would be the book, and I gave it to some trusted readers, including my editor, and I yelled at my wife, and it came back with very positive response, but with everyone sort of feeling like I wished there was more of the grandmother in this book. And I had not intentionally, but very much deliberately, if that makes sense, stayed away from the grandmother. And I think it was because partly I was a little afraid of her, and partly because she was coming through out of this Holocaust narrative, I just, you know, that's always, it's something I think to properly be leery about as a writer, and just, what am I going to say that hasn't been said, or that can't be said, or ought not be said? And so I shied away from her, and I had the excuse in doing that of the fact that she's mysterious, right? Like, as long as I just tell you she's mysterious, then I don't need to explain her, right?
Right. We get off easy that way.
So, right. Yeah, exactly. And clearly that wasn't satisfying to readers. So I went back and did this rewrite, and this was the sort of second magical experience of this book, because as soon as my readers opened that door for me, or forced me through that door, pushed me through, I started to write, and I found that I knew so much about this grandmother that I didn't know that I knew. And that the fact, it was fine for her to be mysterious, it was fine for her to be enigmatic, but then I needed to write about the experience of what it's like to live with such an enigmatic, mysterious
and
person.
The thing is,
so
she,
hard to pin down.
She's present physically, very much remains kind of off limits.
When
I think.
You don't know who she's going to be on it, she's changeable, so I, in that list, that was how I started with her. I just thought, I'm going to just start with some facts.
Was that after you'd sort of gone back in?
I think it was maybe the first thing I did when I sat down to try to just talk about the grandmother. And I had this list framework already established in the book as sort of I think it's a reflection of the grandfather's character, and that he's a list maker, he's an engineer.
Right.
There's a number of parts in the book where he's in a kind of dire situation, and his response to the dire situation is mentally, he's like, okay, I have three options here, right? Like, I could do this, no, that wouldn't be a good thing, I could do that. So the list kind of, the numbered list like that had already emerged, and I thought, okay, I'm gonna do a list about the grandmother, and it's gonna be from the point of view of the narrator when he's a kid. And this was really the first time, other than the narrator being the narrator and sitting with his dying grandfather, I hadn't ever gone into the narrator's life, per se, in this book yet. So I said, okay, I'm going to pretend I'm 4 years old, and I'm looking at this woman, and I'm a kid who's just trying to put things together for the first time, and I'm confronted with this mysterious woman, who's both warm and funny and tender and affectionate and fun to be around, and dark and depressed and moody and sullen and damaged and hurting and can't get out of bed. And you never know which grandmother it's gonna be. And that's the list kind of emerged from that.
And this, I mean, this, you know, when you read the book, you'll, this will happen to you, but I think you get a sense of what's driving the grandfather, but in a way that he doesn't quite understand or even know how to get through, mm-hmm. because it's her, mm-hmm. it's always her. Mm-hmm. And you know, it isn't just the seven, it's going back to that list, her coat that smells of Chanel number 5. I mean, there's, mm-hmm. there's way, you know, she sort of has this presence, and she also has this career, mm-hmm. as an entertainer, as a witch, as a radio personality,
yeah.
As an actress, mm-hmm. and she just has all of these things that kind of add this other element to the book. You know, when I'm interested, you know, I'm reading about the grandfather's obsession with rockets, but it's always, it's her,
yeah,
and her past.
Getting to the moon, I mean, he makes her a promise shortly after they first meet in Baltimore, right after the war, and the grandfather's brother, Uncle Ray, sort of teasingly, there's taunting his brother by saying, this guy, you wouldn't think to look at him, he looks like a hunk of cement, but he wants to go to the moon, he wants to fly to the moon,
right.
And then the grandmother says to the grandfather, like, will you take me with you when you go? And he says, yeah, I'll figure it out. So, right. Like, he makes this promise to her, and in a way, then that he loses his encounter with Wernher von Braun, he doesn't actually meet von Braun during the war, but he encounters his work in the form of the concentration camp Dora and the factory in the middle work. He sees the truth about what he has been the sort of vision to him of a rocket to the moon, and it's damaging for him. And then, so that in a way, by making the promise to this mysterious, beautiful woman that he falls in love with very quickly, it's a sort of a way of renewing and redeeming that promise, but in a different, that vision in a different way.
And here's a kind of a boring, crafty, writing-y question. Mm-hmm. I apologize for in advance, but what you're talking about, all this sort of happens, I want to ask you about time and how you sort of solved the problem of time in this book. And you mentioned in a piece you wrote for the New York Times that, you know, the structure was new to you, or it kind of came organically for this, mm-hmm. particular book. And it seems like kind of getting to know her might have been part of it, but sort of allowing us, because we move from the war and the grandfather's experience in the war back to, you know, the 1980s, mm-hmm. when all this has started emerging in, you know, in the story that he's getting from his grandfather, back to the 30s, back to the 50s, we move from New York to Philadelphia to Florida to D.C. a little bit, to Baltimore. We're moving around a lot. I'm wondering time and place and how you manage that at your desk.
Well, you know, I've never been able to do anything but start at the beginning, go through the middle, and try to get to the end. And the few times I've tried skipping as a sort of just a problem-solving technique, because I feel stuck, because middles are so, they're just so big,
right?
Compared to beginnings, right. and endings, right. which are, you know,
that's why
it's all middle, really.
Boris said he skipped page the middles. One. He said, forget the middles. Exactly. The beginning.
Yeah, again. So yeah. I'm lost in the middle. I always get horribly lost and start to really feel like, I don't know why I ever thought this was a good idea to write this book in the first place. And I've tried a couple times, like, fine, screw it. I'm just going to skip this stupid part. I'm going to go to the next part and just, and I can't even do that. If I start to just get this sense, this really sense of anxiety, like, how can I possibly write what came after if I don't know what happened before yet? Like, things, you find things out when you're writing, and if I don't know that, then anyway, I've never been able to do it. With this book, because of this, I had this actual memory, this actual experience of sitting with my grandfather when he was, you know, high on Dilaudid, and
right.
and just stuff was coming out.
And it was,
you know,
coming,
like,
out from different
did I ever tell
time
you about
frames.
The time I dropped a cat out of the window, and it was three stories up, and, you know, and then he was, like, telling me about my mom when she was a kid, or right. then remembering something about me when I was a kid, and there was no chronology to his memory. So because I had that as my given, it seemed to free me up to jump more. And so what I what I did was I sort of, there are a bit, essentially there are like six time periods, six right. threads in the book. And so I basically got them all going. I got them all up and running. So I wrote until I felt like it was up and running. I wrote this section, and then when I felt like I had it going, I went to the next, and I did that for a while until I got to the World War II parts, and then I felt like I just gotta, this is a big slog, I gotta just get through this, and so I wrote those whole sections start to finish, and then I went back and started finishing the other sections.
It had the feeling like there was like this tether to like this the present, where I could feel it like, you know, the narrator sort of imagining this, so I felt okay when I, you know, I would always like, I knew he was going to come back. Mm-hmm. I knew he was going to talk to his mom mm-hmm. and that they were going to not know the answers to things. Mm-hmm. And then I would go back mm-hmm. into the grandfather's
Because you're always in the narrator's point of view, even when you're in the grandfather's point
right.
of view. Because obviously, I mean, and this is the thing with memoir, of course, with actual memoir that goes unacknowledged a lot of the time. But, you know, not only is it highly unlikely that that the grandfather would be remembering these things in such detail to his grandson after 40 years, but then it's also unlikely that the grandson, 25 years after his grandfather's death, would be able to remember these such a detailed account. So then you know, okay, obviously the narrator is novelizing here, he's embellishing, so even when it's fully through the eyes of the grandfather and the thoughts of the grandfather, and the narrator's voice doesn't directly intrude, you're always aware that this is still the grandson's version of his grandfather's
And what
story.
I so appreciated is that you don't make a big deal of that. It just sort of happens. Because I think this is what we do. Mm-hmm. I think we tell our grandparents' stories, mm-hmm. we tell our parents' stories mm-hmm. sort of running in our head mm-hmm. all the time, and which gets me to parenthood and fatherhood in particular. I have a million questions, so I'm cutting to well, some of my later ones. Mm-hmm. But
get the kid out of the bed.
Yeah,
that's my big advice.
Right. Fatherhood, and in this book in particular, many people probably in the audience know this beautiful essay you wrote about your son Abe in GQ, mm-hmm. about going to Fashion Week in Paris with him. And I had read that actually while I was waiting for my own son to be born. Wow. It was sort of a, you know, as I knew this event was coming, and I was mm-hmm. like, oh, I gotta read up, you know, and
I better prepare.
Yeah, exactly, for my life.
It's gonna be a test.
Know? And so, but I, you know, it was an incredibly moving essay, and I know
thank you.
If y'all haven't read it, you should absolutely read it. It's beyond fatherhood. It's about a person, and it's a beautifully done piece, and it turned me back to the book, and to a particular scene, and I wanted to ask you to read it. There's a moment in the book where, as you mentioned, you alluded to, that the arrest and imprisonment of the grandfather for 20 months for attacking the president of the company that he now works for after having gone broke for reasons that you all need to read about. But the grandmother, you know, causes a considerable amount of trouble, sad trouble. But at one point, the father has to go to prison, and the mother at this point is mentally ill and not able to care for her daughter. Therefore, the daughter at this point, who's what, maybe 14?
Yeah,
has to be given to the care of Uncle Ray, who's a fascinating character, former rabbi, now pool hustler. Mm-hmm.
And much happier as a pool hustler
exactly.
than as a
and
rabbi.
And more successful, I
yeah.
think.
Yeah.
So he's dropping her off at this Uncle Ray's house, and you know, and here's the goodbye has to happen. And I should say, because it's very early in the book, and it's not giving anything away, to say that he's actually not a real father. Mm-hmm. He adopted.
He's their stepfather.
Yeah, he's their stepfather mm-hmm. from when she was four. Her real father was killed.
Yeah, you find that out
war.
Very early.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. When he first meets the grandmother, he's very shortly thereafter learns she has a four-year-old daughter.
And you sort of. It hits you pretty hard even later when you kind of remember that. And mm-hmm. I remembered it at this moment. Mm-hmm. And I thought, if you don't mind, to just get
sure.
us into the spirit of the book. And I'm not exactly sure where to... It's the scene that I loved
oh, yeah.
here, but you might want to start
okay, yeah,
earlier.
So he drives yeah. the daughter... The grandfather drives the mother down to Baltimore to stay with his brother Ray, and Ray is a boarder in this house with this woman named Mrs. Einstein, who is a tough cookie, and is not at all, she's completely unhappy about taking this girl in, feels completely free in saying so, and yet also feels utterly compelled to do so. You know, and has no moral doubts. She knows this is the right thing to do. and as the grandfather kind of realizes that Mrs. Einstein, even though Uncle Ray said it would be fine to bring the girl, now the grandfather realizes maybe Mrs. Einstein is not so fine with it. My grandfather turned on his brother. "You said it was fine with her." "Fine is a relative term," Uncle Ray observed. "Maybe I ought to have said, as fine as anything ever gets with this one." My mother told me that she still remembered the heat spreading across her cheeks as she listened to this exchange. A spasm of restlessness took hold in her legs, a kind of panic in the muscles. She ran through a handful of smart or angry or cold remarks she might toss at Mrs. Einstein on the subject of children and their feelings toward Mrs. Einstein. She reconfirmed with herself the certainty that she had nowhere else to go. "I don't need it to be fine," Mrs. Einstein said. "Obviously, the girl needs a home." It was not yet 8 o'clock when my grandfather took his hat from a peg in the front hall. My mother tried to stay put on Mrs. Einstein's sofa. The sofa was upholstered in pale pink chenille, sealed in a layer of clear vinyl. Under her circle skirt, my mother could feel her bare thighs sticking to the vinyl slipcover, and she pretended that the adhesion would be sufficient. But in the end, she tore loose and ran to her father. He suffered her to put her arms around his waist and her cheek against his shirt front. When he saw that she was not going to make a scene, he took hold of her head with both hands and raised her face to his. "If I thought you were not up to this, I would not ask you to do it," he said. "Do you understand?" My mother nodded. A tear spilled from her left eye, streaked down her temple, and chimed inside her right ear. "You're tough," he said, "like me." He lowered his lips to her forehead and left the scratch of his whiskers on it. Hours afterward, lying on a folding cot in Mrs. Einstein's attic, trying to fall asleep, she could feel the abrasion of his kiss radiating heat across her forehead like a sunburn. It was only then, in the dark and the smell of old luggage and galoshes, that it occurred to my mother she should have asked my grandfather what he would have done if he thought she wasn't up to the ordeal. She lay there in the dark, picturing to herself all the bright forms his mercy might have taken if only she had not been so tough. You know, thank you. I'm realizing there's just like reading that part, and I had not really thought about it before, but oh, thank you. My dad, when my parents separated, and my dad moved out of the house, we lived in Columbia, Maryland. He worked in Baltimore at Sinai Hospital, and he moved into a house, and he moved in with this old woman, I mean, whatever, I don't remember how he would have referred to her, but her name was Mrs. Einstein, and so he was like her boarder, and I'm just sort of realizing now, like, this is, like, that's where he went when he left us to this, so anyway, so in some way, you know, that's the weird way in which this actually is a memoir.
Mrs. Einstein
But it's
returns.
All disguised, yeah.
Well, just the last line, and just, you know, the different forms his mercy might have taken had she been weaker. Mm-hmm. Much of the book kind of centers on that notion. You know, what this family can take, what our families can take, mm-hmm. what we do take.
Mm-hmm.
That it struck me in many ways, as I'm sure it did everyone here. I'm gonna, even though we have, our cue was that more questions come up, but I'm gonna squeeze in one more question.
Go for it.
And that is books, physical, the physical object of books, which is, they come up in your work all the time, and this book is no exception. 9 stories, Herman Oblast's book on rockets, a book called Strangely Enough by C.B. Colby. And I love how you always tell us the publisher, the year. It's you know, for a book geek, it's awesome.
Exactly.
I'm like, oh, right.
You need to know.
You know, Knopf in 1942, that one.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, but I think back to Mysteries of Pittsburgh with the character Cleveland, who stole books and his house is full of books,
mm-hmm.
and Freud's letters and the library and all of these, you know, it comes up all the time. And I wanted to mention one book in particular that you introduced me to through an introduction that you wrote about it. It's called The Long Ships, and it's a Swedish novel.
Great book.
By Franz Bergsten,
something
along those
lines,
that your aunt gave you
at
one point. And you, I just thought I'd read, this is from the introduction, New York Review Books published it, and Michael wrote the introduction, and it introduced me to the book. But this is how his introduction begins. In my career as a reader, I have encountered only 3 people who know The Long Ships, and all of them, like me, loved it immoderately. 4 for 4. From this tiny but irrefutable sample, I dare extrapolate that this novel stands ready, given the chance, to bring lasting pleasure to every single human being on the face of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
How could you not?
It's such a good book.
I really think you believe that, and I of course read it, and he's right.
Good.
And I want to bring that beautiful and strange and wonderful book into the conversation just to kind of close us out, and that is that you say in the introduction, like half the greatest European novels, The Long Ships is big, bloody, and far-ranging, concerned with war, treasure, the grand deeds of men and kings. Like the other half, it is intimate and domestic, centered firmly around the seasons and portraits of village and farm, around weddings and births, around the hearts of women who, I can't even read my own writing, forgive me, hearts of women, but this is key, hearts of women who see only too keenly through the grand pretensions of men and bloody kings. And it, just to go back to the women in this book, the mother in particular, she's 4 years old when her father is killed by the Nazis for treating Jews in the village that they were then carried off to and killed.
Or so she's led to believe.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a nice thing for her to believe.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, it kind of centers around, I think of this 4-year-old kid and you know, what emerged from her,
mm-hmm.
you know, her son and then doubling back. And this connection between big events, you know, the Challenger explosion, which was such a huge thing in my own childhood, and I'm sure many, I remember exactly where I was.
Mm-hmm.
That's in this book, as is the moon landing and everything else. But what is the strength of it in addition to that covering these monumental things is the intimacy of it. So
thank you. Thank you.
So
yeah. Well, thank you, Peter.
Michael has a bunch
yes,
of
I have,
questions.
You've been very, very kind and industrious and diligent in writing these questions, and which I have not reviewed beforehand. And so thank you. And Stephanie, I just want to let you know, I can't see you. I have no idea. So if you're like going to be waving your arms and telling me, stop answering questions, I won't. You have to just, you're going to have to just be a loud Jew and just like shout out like, wait, enough. Okay. Why do you write between 10 p.m. and 3 a.m.? And then, as if there might be some logical connection, do 4 children help or hinder the writing process? And that question kind of answers itself, doesn't it?
There it is.
You know what? You know who's not around between 10 p.m. and 3 o'clock in the morning? Well, not for you. Sorry.
No, yeah, it's not working.
You know, I know that has a lot to do with it, that that in the middle of the night, everyone's asleep. They can't ask you for anything, or there's no intrusions. The only intrusions at that time of the day are the ones that you bring to yourself. Back before there was the internet, that was really almost nothing happened in the middle of the night.
Right.
No phone calls. There was nothing on TV. So it is that to some degree, but also it's just a natural rhythm for me. As soon as I was allowed to stay up as late as I wanted to, whenever that was, I started staying up late. It's just a natural thing. I like to stay up late and sleep late. That's my natural rhythm. And when I've tried so many times over the years to change and be normal and have a normal schedule and get up in the morning like my wife does and get the work done right away so that then you're done with your work. I have my work hanging over my head all day long. I would like to be different than, but I just can't, it just doesn't work for me, so. Do you get permission from your family before you write about them? No. am I supposed to? Is that? No. Here's the thing. When you say your family, I mean, it's a broad term, kind of the catch-all term. And so if you're talking about my parents, no. I do not ask my parents for their permission before I write about them, because I just try to hide it from them as long as possible. I know, because I feel like, look, if you give birth to a writer and you raise a writer, it's your fault.
Oh, that's rough, yeah, totally.
You brought it on yourself. But with our children and with Ayelet, yes, especially if I think, if I really have cause to feel there might be a reason they might not want me to say what I'm saying or write what I'm writing. And so you mentioned that GQ piece about Abe. I mean, Abe knew we went to the Men's Fashion Week in Paris. He was very excited to do that. He knew I was going to be writing about it for GQ. Right. But when I had finished the piece, I gave it to, first person I gave it to after I yelled, it was him to read it and make sure he was cool with it. And he had a couple notes, but they were just like things I had gotten wrong.
About the,
you know, like right. About clothing details or whatever. It was, and I think I even just doubled to like, okay, like, but you're sure like this, it's okay. Like I said, this, it's like, yeah, no, it's fine. So, right. The thing is though, the problem with that and the problem generally with getting permission to write, which I really don't recommend, for writers, is that once you start worrying about how people are going to take what you write, it's kind of all over. And the biggest problem is that things that you would never in a million years expect would be offensive to someone or someone might resent your saying, things that seem completely innocuous can turn out to be embarrassing in ways that you never would have imagined or expected, and things you're really worried about that are like, I don't know if I can say this, and you say it, and no one ever says anything, right. And it goes just sails right by.
Which is almost disappointing.
Yeah,
they don't get upset. I mean, I thought this was supposed to be upsetting.
Right. Story. I've had experience a lot over the years of people thinking, like coming up to me. I remember there's a guy in Pittsburgh who I knew just barely. I had met him once or twice, and many years later, he came to one of my readings, and he said like how much he loved the Mysteries of Pittsburgh, and it was so flattering that I had based the character of Cleveland on him, and like I had just the same kind of motorcycle. I actually had all these things right, weirdly, but I didn't even know this guy. So, it's a mug's game, is what I'm trying to say. Once you start worrying about how people are going to take things,
right,
with your children, you know. It's good to check, but usually I don't think even they necessarily have that kind of consciousness of like this is gonna come back to haunt me someday. Let's see. Uh, I'm looking for the really hostile ones. These are all too friendly. Let's see. What's this? This is a perennial one, and I usually don't have anything to add. But this is, what's the status of a Kavalier and Clay movie? It's nothing good. We tried, actually, we had this flurry of activity. When I say we, I mean Ayelet and I had this flurry of activity around trying to do it as a TV series, thinking that might be a way to really get to tell the whole story, and there's all these, you know, you can do that on TV nowadays. But we ran into deep Hollywood financial, legal, and let's just say dick measuring problems.
Once it gets into dick measuring, I mean, it's over. I mean, what are you going to do?
with various involved entities that made it, we realized it seems to be locked forever within the vault of Paramount Pictures and may never escape. So that's sad, but maybe not. I don't wouldn't put anything past Ayelet. If anyone can make it happen, it would be her. Let's see, Michael, you write about midwives in both Werewolves in Their Youth and Telegraph Avenue. As a midwife, I find it unusual to read male writers referencing our ancient craft. Can you speak about why midwives appear in your stories and what connects you to them?
I have that question also.
Did you?
Yeah, I just did it.
Did your question, finish, P.S. I adore you? Because this one does.
It trumps.
Getting to know midwives, I have four kids, and our first two were both born by cesarean section, the first was born by cesarean section. For the second, Ayelet was really bound and determined to have a vaginal birth and a VBAC, and that became a common project of both of ours. And I mean, as hard as she worked much harder at it than I did, but I worked very hard to make that happen too. And we did it with the help of a midwife. And I mean, we tried to make it happen. And in the end, that guy was a C-section. And after that, she just scheduled the next two because it clearly wasn't going to happen. But there was something about, I think maybe partly because I was so invested in it for Ayelet's sake, that it just seemed to me there was this incredibly profound, it was probably the most profound kind of work, even more in some ways than a doctor, and you think of doctors having this power of life and death and so on, but being a doctor, especially today, is such a mechanized, technological thing to be doing. You're as much an engineer as you are a craftsman or an artist or even just a worker. And it's called labor for a reason. It's the most important work there is, and there's just something about it that just, and the few midwives that we got to know or the at that period all seem to share a certain kind of pragmatic, like I expected a certain kind of like crystals and patchouli and I'm sure there are, I mean, we live in Berkeley, there are a lot of midwives and there's probably some patchouli, but like not, the ones we met weren't like that. They were hard-headed and they were unsentimental, and these are qualities I admire in people generally, and so I just, it fascinated me. Now, I will say that the midwife in the story Werewolves in Their Youth is actually, the character of the midwife in that story is not based on any midwives that I ever met. She's actually based on the writer Dorothy Allison, whom I met once for a couple days. We were at the McDowell Colony together, and she just, she's a very strong person. She just impressed me. Like, I just was like, I'm going to name this midwife Dorothy, and she's going to be Dorothy Allison. And I just wrote Dorothy Allison as I imagine her, just like writing Werner von Braun or
Right.
You know.
I'll just add briefly, because I've just been through this, how amazing our midwife was, just a midwife. Mm-hmm. And also how untechnical. You mentioned this, the doctors sort of bringing mm-hmm. this technical, but mm-hmm. It was sort of like, I was like amazed about how untechnical
it
was.
Yes, this is about touching and holding and sensing and like,
yeah, it just felt
no,
felt right.
And then when, you know.
And turning, I was crazy.
Yeah.
Crazy. Anyway, we'll go on to the next question.
And that's the thing. And so like, okay, I'm just going to be totally honest. When I was working on Telegraph Avenue, I mean, it's embarrassing now in hindsight. I probably shouldn't confess this, but I kind of thought like I'm gonna do the Moby Dick of Oakland, California. And so once I just thought like I'm gonna do the Moby Dick of Oakland, California, what's my whaling gonna be? Like what's the work of this book gonna be? It's not gonna be these guys who own the record stores. That's not work. They're having too much fun and they just stand around talking all day. And then I thought, oh no, the wailing of this book is going to be midwifery. Like I really want to learn about it. And so the little I knew from having direct experience was I tried to really supplement and augment by talking to midwives and doing a lot of research. And the internet was an incredible resource for me because there's all these incredible birth stories that women write.
Right.
I was confronted with this problem. I had set it for myself of trying to write a scene from the point of view of a woman giving birth, and not just like a woman, but an African-American woman, and I needed all the help I could get, and I found so much in that on those resources, so. Oh, right, I have the questions. I was like waiting. When you were in Israel last, did you find areas of cultural connection that could offer a bridge toward peace? No. Cultural connection, I mean, I would like to think so. Last time I went to Israel was with Ayelet. It was in May, April, it was in April. And we went as part of a group of writers for an anthology that Ayelet and I have co-edited, where we asked writers from all over the world, every country, I mean every continent, literally every continent except Antarctica. Penguins don't want to have anything to do with, with Israel-Palestine.
They're for peace, question, but they can't. No. Nobody listens to them.
Every kind of background, we brought them in and we toured the occupied territories. And that was what that trip was about. It was just seeing up close, firsthand, going over to the other side and just seeing with our own eyes. And so it was not about peace. And I don't, and it, that's not to say it was about war. It was about seeing the occupation. And, you know, I mean, I guess all I can really say about it is it's pretty clear to me. It's, you know, the house is on fire. The house is burning down. And when a house is on fire, you don't stop and argue with each other about, it's full of children, you know? There's people in that house, you have to get them out, and you don't stop arguing about who set the fire. You could stand there on the sidewalk all night, letting the house burn down, arguing about who was smoking in bed or whose fault it is. None of us would do that in those circumstances. When you see a house on fire, you know, put it out. And that was, you know, not about really, I'm sorry to say, it was not about a bridge towards peace. It was much more of an it felt like much more of an emergency to me than that. And after you put the fire out, okay, then let's try to figure out how to, you know, rebuild or keep it from happening again or whatever, but this is not the time.
We may be farther away from that.
I feel that way, doesn't it? Oh, here's on the same blue card. These are the serious questions on the blue index card. How can literary artists like you help youth understand what it means to be a Jew in today's world? Reading fiction matters. well, what it means to be a Jew, I mean, yeah, that's a subject I think I have been addressing, trying to address in one way or another for my last many books now, maybe a little less in Telegraph Avenue than in the ones before and then in this one. But this is a very Jewy book. And, you know, for me, I mean, all youth have are stories. And, you know, when it comes to, say, something, well, like the immigrant experience, the Jewish immigrant experience, that generation is gone. You know, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, they've been gone for a while. When you're talking about the Holocaust, that generation is going. And the young people today are going to come of age in a world where there are no more living survivors. It's happening. It's coming sooner rather than later. And then what? Then what do we have? All we have is stories. And so there's this, I don't know, I can't predict what that's going to be like, but I think for a very long time we've had this sense of the importance of eyewitness testimony and of firsthand testimony and the primacy of that kind of testimony. And fortunately, a lot of that has been recorded and has been written, and mm-hmm. there have been books and there have been documentaries, and you know, that all exists. But if we don't want it to ossify, if we don't want it to sort of, as time goes by, generations to come, sort of put it in the box and push it over in the corner, you know, I think we have to keep talking about it. But those of us who came after, and those of us who came after those who came after, it's going to be all about stories, telling stories.
Would you say there's a connection between the two previous questions and maybe what you're doing, what you and Ayelet's anthology is about? Is there?
Yeah,
is there,
I mean, that's why we wanted writers, because you know, we've all seen, or we feel that we've all seen the pictures, we've all read the stories. Now, of course, the news articles, those are, depending on where you're reading them, they're going to be presented with this strange appearance of neutrality. And I'm talking about all the sources of news and information we have. There's this like pretense of neutrality, pretense of objectivity, a little bit like with memoirs, right? But of course, we all know there is a slant, there is editorial, and there's a kind of, there can be sometimes a kind of both, it might be bad faith in some cases, in other cases it's sincere intention to report, but is ultimately always going to be colored by unspoken or unconscious biases. With novelists, these are people accustomed to being upfront and clear about biases and about where I'm coming from on this. And I feel like if someone's upfront with you about this is where I'm coming from, then you can trust the story within the frame of what they're acknowledging their biases are. I feel like much more comfortable in that context, just as I feel much more comfortable with novels than I do with memoirs.
It makes me upfront. Think in the book, the grandfather, who's not a big reader of fiction, he does have one book he loves, and that's Magic Mountain. And when he's a young man, he writes in bold letters, humanism, on the flyleaf of the book. Yeah. I just thought that, like, you know, so writers wear their humanism openly. And,
yes.
But I think a lot of people find that tough to swallow. Well, and they might say the writers are as biased as anybody.
I think one of the greatest responsibilities we all have in life, and this is not just when we're talking about Israel and Palestine, it's true with your children, it's true with your spouse, it's true with the people that you deal with, is you have to question your assumptions. You have to question, why do I think the things that I think? Because it's so easy to mistake the things you think for the truth. That's the only experience you have of the truth, is through your own thought process. And so they can become quite indistinguishable. And yet, of course, they often bear no relation to one another at all. And
right.
and there's nothing to be done about that. That's just how we are as human beings. And we all put a spin on things. We all feel loyalty to our in-group or the group we belong to. And that puts us almost unwittingly in an oppositional stance to people who are in a different group from us. And we can fight against that. We can resist it in a lot of different ways. And I think we have to. But I think the fastest and most reliable way is just by not taking the things that you think for granted as true.
You have an essay. I think there's other questions, but I wanted
okay.
to.
One more question?
I'm going to. You know, there's the elephant in the room. There's a lot, you know, we're ending the Obama era as
yes.
ending.
Oh, that elephant.
And I wasn't going to mention the Trump word, but I just did. But you have an essay about watching Obama on the night of the election in Grant Park. In
yeah, 2008, home, yeah.
In my hometown of Chicago, and I wish I was there. But I wasn't. I was watching it on TV, mm-hmm. You had your son on your shoulders.
Yeah, my daughter, Rose.
Yeah. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Yeah. And she was on TV. They showed her.
Ah, I think
our texts were like we just saw Rose. Yeah.
So you, this is in a different essay where you cast suspicions on the idea of I'm going to talk about the Eisenhower years, or I'm going to talk about the Greatest Generation, and mm-hmm. and the impossibility of doing that.
Yeah, periodizing.
Yeah, yeah. And periodizing and the danger of that. And mm-hmm. yet you kind of do it because we all,
yeah,
do it.
Can't help it.
And I'm just wondering about, any thoughts for us as we end the Obama years? I know this is an impossible question.
I know.
But what the hell? Because, because as you suggest, writers have a role in
I would
this.
Like to think so.
Yeah. So
I would
so what now, Michael?
Yeah. What now? Well... Obviously, we have to pay attention and not get comfortable. And, this the night of the election, the late unpleasantness, Ayala and I, and maybe other people in this room, had a similar conversation. When do we know when it's time to go? Right? As Jews, I mean. And then there's a part of you, there's a voice that says, don't be silly. Don't be ridiculous. You're being hysterical. You're exaggerating. This is America. We're Americans. Right? I wonder, who ever said things like that before in the history of the Jewish people, right? And so then that's your next thought is, okay, I'm now saying all these things the Jews of Germany said to themselves in the beginning. They said, he's a clown, he's ridiculous, don't be hysterical, whatever. And then we all grew up in this age of reading about the ones that either just by chance, by luck, by maybe they were hysterical and neurotic and histrionic, but they left, right? They got out in time. And I don't know about you, but when I read about those people, I'm always have that feeling that would be me, right? I'd be one of those people, right? I would know. Somehow I would know when it was time to go. And then you have the next thought after that is this is you're being silly.
This is
not even president yet. And I think at the very least even if it God willing never comes to that or even remotely anything like that, not just for Jews, I have to say, but for Muslims and for Mexicans and for all the other people who have been or may be targeted by that kind of hate, it will, even if nothing comes of all of it, it won't hurt to be vigilant, to be, to not get complacent, to pay attention, to resist if it comes to that, when the time comes, to protest and to do the things that we might wish more people had done, and not just in Germany in the 30s, in other places in the world too, where things, in the way that they do with human beings, got horribly out of hand.
You say that you're constantly searching for home, and that through your faith and through your, thinking about Jewish stories and this search for home, and it just makes me think, we're still searching in some mm-hmm. ways, and, if, and this is mm-hmm. making us search more.
Yeah, I mean, I feel shaken by it. I feel my confidence shaken. So that, you know, I was thinking today about, just passed through my mind, this, the Philip K. Dick novel, The Man in the High Castle. Mm. And then it was made into a Netflix TV series. And I don't know, it flitted through my mind, and I don't really quite remember why. And instead of just continuing on its way, which I'll say, if you don't know, it's a novel, it's a counterfactual novel set in the United States in the 1960s in a world where Germany and Japan won the Second World War, and they've divided the United States between them, and Germany controls more than half of the United States, and Japan controls the West Coast. And you know, you can't write a counterfactual without a certain kind of cosmic fundamental smugness about how things actually turned out, right? Like you write the novel about what if the Confederacy had won the Civil War,
right,
because you know the Union won the Civil War, and that was decided, and it's never gonna change. And so you have that kind of distance from it that enables you to fully imagine it. And it felt like, it has always felt like that with these sort of, like, there's fatherland. This has been done in other books too. You know, it's been under a bell jar for me, and for, I think, for us as readers to think about, well, that didn't happen. Mm-hmm. So it feels kind of safe. It's almost like you're scaring yourself in a safe way to write about, well, what if it had happened? And suddenly when this story flitted through my mind today, I was like, ooh, I don't know if I don't feel that safe. Like, I don't feel so smug anymore. I guess that's what I'm talking about. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.